I'm Clarence Padilla, and I am the clarinet professor here at Drake University in Des Moines, Iowa. And I'm also a clarinetist and personnel manager for the Des Moines Symphony. Welcome to the Turner Jazz Center and the campus of Drake University. I want to thank Chris Strohmeyer and the Iowa Bandmasters Association for inviting me to share today's video presentation with you entitled Clarinetics. As you've probably discovered by now, I will be speaking today about teaching and playing the clarinet, a quote, nuts and bolts, end quote, tutorial of the instrument that I've been playing for almost 50 years and teaching for almost 30 years. Today, we'll discuss three important topics associated with the clarinet. First, tone, then technique, and then finally, articulation. Then at the end, I'll give a short musical performance of one of my all-time favorite pieces, The Carnival of Venice. So talking about tone quality, the first thing I always recommend is being able to describe what kind of tone a clarinetist should have. So in my mind, the description of the clarinet tone should start with a color. And the color in my mind is the color burgundy or purple. It has some dark colors, but it's not so dark that it won't resonate. And then if I were thinking of a fabric that I would associate with the clarinet tone, I would say it'd have to be velvet because it has the thickness, it has the warmth that a clarinet tone should have. And if I were to think of what the taste of a clarinet tone should be, then I would say it would be chocolate. It's sweet, it's rich, but you don't necessarily need to indulge too much in it. It's just still very, very light. So in producing the clarinet tone, one of the main ideas that we have to think about, one of the concepts is how we form the embouchure. And of course, you all know that for the clarinet, the chin, the embouchure, must be very, very flat in order to produce the optimum tone quality on the clarinet. And so this chin needs to be more in this area. If you were to ask your students, or if you were to say the letter V, 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 this way, that is one way to produce the correct chin formation for the clarinet embouchure. And then once you start blowing into the clarinet, obviously we stop saying V, that is only to form the embouchure, but then I also, when I blow into the clarinet, I will say the syllable oo, so something like this. And one thing I'd like to show you is if the chin is absolutely flat, then there's going to be space between the reed and the chin itself. Oftentimes when I visit schools and work with the clarinetists, I see the chin sort of bunched up against the reed. And in that example, you can hear that the tone isn't very resonant. So once again, you want space between the chin and the reed. Now, another way to check the embouchure is the firmness or looseness of the embouchure. Now on a clarinet embouchure, we want to have a firm embouchure, but we don't necessarily want a tight embouchure. And of course, we don't want a loose embouchure because that's going to affect the tone. So there are a couple ways I would like to recommend to you to check your student's embouchure firmness in order to produce the optimum tone. So one way is to go ahead and separate the clarinet mouthpiece and the clarinet barrel this way. And what you'll notice is if you ask your students to go ahead and play just this portion of the clarinet, if they have the correct firmness of their embouchure, they will produce a G sharp, their written G sharp, on the top of the staff this way. If it's too loose, they will play a pitch that is lower than that G sharp that you just heard. So once again, this is a great way to check because this is the pitch they should be producing if their embouchure firmness and their chin is flat. Another way would be to remove the mouthpiece itself and play only on the mouthpiece. And the appropriate pitch to produce with the mouthpiece only to check for firmness, they should produce a D above the staff. And if it's too loose, it'll sound like this. And of course, if it's too tight, they won't get any sound hardly at all. It'll sound very pinched. And of course, that means that their embouchure is too clenched and too tight, and they're probably biting on the reed too much. So that's another way to check that their embouchure firmness is appropriate for playing the clarinet. Okay, I've got the clarinet back together again. And of course, when you're teaching your students to play the clarinet, be sure that when they do play, their embouchure is staying absolutely still. Whether they're tonguing, whether they're slurring, whether they're playing loud, whether they're playing soft, whether they're playing in one register, or the upper register, low register, or transitioning. So again, just playing in any capacity, the embouchure should stay very still. And really, the embouchure should only be moving when the student takes a breath. Now, of course, one very important concept is how to use the wind and how to use the air. When I teach clarinet, I use the word wind more often than I use the word air, because wind is active. There is air in the room that I'm speaking in right now, but it's not moving and we don't necessarily feel it. So I find much more success in teaching my students when I use the word wind, so that they sense the idea of blowing a constant wind pressure at all times. So I teach my students at the very beginning to do a lot of long tones. And it makes them, inspires them to take much bigger breaths all the time. And of course, this is designed so that they take this kind of breath every time they play a musical passage. So I ask them to turn the metronome on to 60. And I ask them just to play, they can play the first four notes of a scale or the first four notes of a chromatic scale. With my college students, I ask them to take a breath and be able to breathe in one, to play a passage in one breath for 16 seconds, so something like this.
Hi.
so forth and so on. So by practicing those 16-second breaths, that is going to repeat the action that clarinet students, really all wind players, should have all the time, taking deep breaths and making yourself play for at least 60 seconds at any given time. Now, with an elementary student, it may not be 16 seconds, of course, and so maybe you're asking them to play for 8 seconds without having to stop and take a breath. And perhaps at the middle school level, it could be somewhere between 12 and 16 seconds on one breath. And of course, as they get older, in 11th and 12th grade, and that's when I would be asking them to play for anywhere between 16 and as much as 20 seconds on one breath. So breathing is obviously an important part of playing a wind instrument. And again, getting back to the schools, usually students, in my opinion, don't take enough air in order to play that long. Or they do it at the very beginning of a piece, but they don't do it throughout a piece. So I would, again, ask you to expect them to be able to play anywhere between 12 and 16 or up to 20 seconds on one breath. Now, we talked about taking a breath and playing for a duration of time. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about how to test your students for support, and that means being able to push the air out at the proper speed. I truly believe that the faster you blow air through your clarinet, the better the tone will be. So as you see, I've taken the bell off of my clarinet, and the little exercise or modeling I'm about to show you works best with an older student, but basically what I'm going to do is plug the end of my instrument by sitting like this way. But you may be able to find something to plug into the end of the clarinet for a younger student that can't sit like this. But what I'm going to do now is play a third line B, B natural in the staff. Obviously, I am providing some sort of resistance at the end of my instrument, so it's going to be harder to push the air through the instrument. But if I push hard enough, I'm still going to be able to create a tone like this. So what I'm feeling right now is a pressure to push harder than usual. It's not so hard that I won't create a tone, but it's just hard enough that I have to push with my diaphragm in order to create the sound. And then, of course, when I put my bell back on, the tone is going to be a lot bigger, a lot fuller, because I'm going to push exactly the same way as I just attempted a minute ago. And you will see that your student's tone will just get bigger, fuller, and you'll be able to hear them much better with this type of wind support when playing the clarinet. And the final element of tone production, obviously, is the reed itself. As you probably know, with a beginning clarinetist, they're probably going to start on a number 2 strength reed. But what I find in the schools is that the students play on a soft reed for too long. So as they get into perhaps 6th or 7th grade, I always encourage you to have your students start playing on harder reeds. So maybe 2.5, maybe even up to a number 3 strength. So that would be grades 6 through 8, possibly. And then in grades 9 through 12, then I always encourage teachers to suggest to their students that they start playing number 3 and number 4 reed strengths, just to make sure that that they're just working a little bit harder with their wind, because the harder the reed, the darker the tone. And of course, in your bands and orchestras, you want your clarinet players to play with a darker tone versus a brighter tone. And a slightly harder reed will also produce a fuller tone quality as well. And then my final suggestion about reeds is to encourage your students to change their reeds more often. I find that students, even at the college level, will play a reed far too long than it really can live. And so I always encourage my students, or at least inform them, that a reed's life is somewhere only about 20 to 25 hours. Otherwise, that reed becomes unresponsive, it becomes a little squeaky, and then it becomes flat in pitch and bright in tone. So somewhere around the 20 to 25 hours. I obviously buy a lot of reeds at one time. I'll buy boxes of reeds at one time, and then when I go through a box of reeds, I open all 10. And make sure that I'm picking the best three or four out of a box of 10. I've never played all 10 out of a box because we are obviously dealing with an unpredictable element here, and some reeds play well and some reeds do not. So out of a box of 10, I probably play only about four, maybe five reeds. And there will be a document that I'll be sharing with this video about reed brands, reed strengths, so forth and so on. So if everything is going well with the embouchure, with the wind, and your students have a very good reed, good responsive reed, then the tone of the clarinet should sound something like this. The next element I'd like to talk about is technique on the clarinet. As you know, technique is very important on the clarinet, because if the fingers are not accurate, if they're not sealing the clarinet doesn't speak. So at the very beginning stages in elementary and junior high school, most likely what you're dealing with is just making sure the tone produces. And if the embouchure is correct, then obviously they can produce a sound, but then the next step is making sure that they can finger pitches and that every note is coming out from one to the next. So one thing that I always encourage you to do is just check your student's hand position. And so what I try and do is making sure that students form the letter C with their left hand and, of course, their right hand. So forming the letter C with both hands. And what you're trying to get away from, obviously, is this type of finger technique where everything is so far away. Because the clarinet requires absolute sealing of every single note on our instrument, we're trying to keep them very close. And by having this C formation in their minds, they're more likely to seal the clarinet as they are playing whatever passage that they are working on. The other element that I try and encourage is using the flat part of your student's fingers, and just making sure that they're not pointing into the holes of the clarinet, but again using the flat or fleshy part of their fingers to seal the holes, so that they get an automatic seal with the clarinet and there's no grace period where the note doesn't speak and then all of a sudden the note speaks. So for example, this is a bad example I'm going to show you, but if one of my fingers is not covering and it's going to be the third finger of my left hand, it's going to sound like this. And they get that kind of sound instead of. So making sure that the hands are forming the letter C and that they're using the flat part of their fingers will help with the clarinet being able to be sealed immediately. And then also observe your students' pinkies. The pinkies tend to fly away with students and they tend to hold them out way out here as far from the clarinet as possible. And again, sometimes it's difficult, but if you can teach at early levels to keep their pinkies closer to these keys, then as they maneuver through all of these different keys on the clarinet, they can find them, identify them, and play them with facility and speed as they improve on the instrument. Another aspect about teaching technique on the clarinet is the use of the left thumb. As you know, the left thumb is responsible for covering this hole as well as pushing the register key. And I always recommend that the left thumb be at an angle, at a 45 degree angle, as opposed to a 90 degree angle. That way, when the register key is depressed, they could still keep their thumb sealed on the thumb hole. And if they have to use the register key, it's more of a pivot as opposed to a slide. So we're trying to avoid the slide this way because what that will do is create another leak on the back of the clarinet. So again, try to encourage your students to place their thumb at a 45 degree angle when playing the clarinet. At the beginning levels, I always encourage teachers to teach their students the chromatic scale first. I am a firm believer that if young students, young clarinet students, learn all the notes as quickly as possible, then that's going to help them down the road. So I encourage you to teach chromatic scales and also the alternate fingerings on the clarinet right away. But start with the basic chromatic scale. So that they learn every note on the clarinet. That way, when they're playing passages and various repertoire in all different keys, they're learning, they have the facility to play all of the notes and they start becoming accustomed with all keys rather just than one, two, or three. For example, C major, everyone loves to play in C, G, and F. But we eventually have to learn all of the different keys. Following the chromatic scale, then of course I think it's important that students learn all of their major scales and then eventually learn all of their minor scales. Teaching technique on the clarinet involves a lot of practice and fingering patterns. And I know of nothing better than for students to practice scales, diatonic scales, major and minor scales, major and minor arpeggios, major and minor thirds. So in my presentation, you will see a packet by a very close colleague of mine, Robert Spring, that I encourage my students to play as often as possible. But it starts with long tones, and then it starts with working on fingers. And so every day I practice all of my major and minor scales, and I encourage my students to do this as well. And maintaining good hand position and finger position, then of course the next thing we have to work on is facility and speed. So these days, it's taken me a while to get to this speed, but these days I practice all of my major and minor scales this way. ¶¶ So when I'm moving my fingers, what happens with students sometimes is they get a little timid in how they use their wind. So again, get back to the basics and making sure that they're still taking that deep breath that we were working on earlier to produce the tone. But that same kind of breath, that same kind of support must be there when they start moving the fingers. So what I see sometimes in the schools is when they're playing something slow, they take this beautiful breath. But as soon as they have to play something fast, then it becomes. And it becomes that kind of tone. So again, encourage your students to take the same kind of breath all the time, whether they're playing fast or whether they're playing slow. All right, the third component that I'd like to talk about today is articulation, tonguing on the clarinet. So the first thing, obviously we cannot see what's happening inside my, you can't see what's happening inside my mouth, and you can't see what's happening inside your student's mouth. So this is more of a question that you have to ask your students. And so when I start with a new student here at Drake, and we're talking about articulation, I always make sure, number one, I always ask them to tell me what part of their tongue is touching what part of the reed. And obviously what we're looking for is using the tip of your tongue that should be touching just below the tip of the reed. Over the course of my journey in teaching clarinet, I found a few students that have arrived to Drake, and but they were tonguing with the middle of their tongue rather than the tip of their tongue. Tonguing with the middle of their tongue is called anchor tonguing, and it doesn't sound any different when a student tongues like that, but they're not able to generate any speed. And so that becomes a revelation sometimes because they've been using a certain part of their tongue rather than the correct part of their tongue. So do make sure that they are using the tip of their tongue and touching just below the tip of the reed. Now, in teaching different styles of articulation, I simply use different syllables with my students. So in order to tongue regularly, so if we're tonguing just regular eighth notes or regular quarter notes, I use the syllable ta, T-A, ta, ta. And if I'm teaching legato, or very connected articulation, then I ask my students to think of the syllable da, D-A, da. So you still hear the attack of every single note, but obviously everything is very connected. So that's da. For legato. And then probably the most difficult articulation style to teach is staccato. And I use the syllable tut, tut, T-U-T. Now what's important about teaching this syllable is making sure that their air pressure is always behind the tongue. So when you hear this, I continue to blow, however, I am not making any sound because I'm saying the syllable tut, and when my tongue comes back to the reed, it's going to stop the tone, but I am still pushing. So that's all in one breath. Obviously, I'm not taking a breath for each one of those staccato notes. The other thing that I hope you see is that when I do tongue, I don't move my embouchure. When I get out in the school sometimes, I see something like this. So your students should still be able to tongue without moving their chin. Otherwise, they can only tongue as fast as their chin can move, and that's not going to be very fast. So in order to develop speed, tip to tip, and then make sure that their embouchure is staying still. So here are three passages. This is the normal articulation TA. This is legato, D-A, da. And this is staccato, tut. Now, the next aspect of teaching articulation is speed. And this is something that needs to be practiced every day. Woodwind players can't just tongue fast on a single day unless we practice up to it. So again, getting back to my Robert Spring packet, he adds a articulation study that I encourage my students to do every day and that I do every day, and you'll see that in my presentation as well. And this is a staccato study that, again, I encourage my students to start at a very slow tempo and then work up for speed. So I'll play it at this tempo for now. Using a tut staccato syllable. And then over the course of time, I encourage my students to play it faster. And by doing that every single day, then you can develop speed in the articulation. But again, tip to tick, use syllables to teach different styles, and then incorporate some sort of tonguing study every single day to develop speed. So by devoting practice time to these three areas, tone, technique, and articulation, I hope your students are able to develop strong foundational skills in playing the clarinet. And before I perform for you today, I want to announce that over the last 16 months, I have recorded all 52 of the selected studies by Jaime Voxman. These are the etudes that are required for auditioning for the annual Iowa All-State Honor Band and Orchestra. So I was fortunate enough to be given a sabbatical about a year and a half ago, and I recorded all 52 etudes. It was much more difficult than I ever imagined, but it is finished. And I do want you to know that this summer I'll be posting them on YouTube and also providing a little bit of commentary for each of those etudes regarding fingerings, regarding tempos, articulation, breathing, those types of suggestions. So I will be sending those out in the next few months. So if this will hopefully benefit your students as they prepare for their All-State auditions every single year. To close, I am going to play one of my favorite pieces. This is the Carnival of Venice by Paul Jeanjean, and my accompanist today is Liz Augsburger. Thank you so much for being here and watching this video. I hope you have a great day.